In this issue of Real Magic, magician and actor Steve Valentine talks to John Lovick about his new video encyclopedia, Magic on the Go, and about creating his very personal one-man show.
I'd never written magic scripting. I'd always kind of semi-improvised what I was going to do and sort of write. But it's very freeing in a strange way to script a magic trick because you can actually see the rhythm of the piece and, okay, well, there's a lot of exposition here, or there's a lot of action that needs to be covered with either humor or something needs to happen here. And it was really interesting to kind of analyze, go from that point. But I wrote the script without worrying about how I was going to do the magic.
Yeah.
And so the stories and kind of a lot of it was very open and very honest and very vulnerable. And then I ended up with a rather large screenplay, and then had to figure out how to do the magic in sequence, which, as you know, is pocket management.
Yeah.
Where he's going to do props, where are you going to get rid of the props, how are you going to get in and out of the magic, all that stuff. So it was very hard. Writing the script was pretty brutal. And then figuring out how to do the magic. And then the magic I wanted to do was stuff from either my past or vintage magic that no one does.
Yeah.
And then I had to track down those props.
Yeah, yeah.
And then track down the duplicates of those props.
Yeah.
So I've got extra ones. And so we did it and it ended up working. And it's been a lot of fun. It was a lot of work. The original show was 2.5 hours long. There's an 80-minute version that I'm doing in Hollywood right now. But I like the longer version because I don't like rushing to get the show done. I want to like get to know the audience.
Yeah.
And here's the interesting thing that came out of the show was the first half of the show is a ton of magic. Mm-hmm. Because what I wanted to do was satiate my audience so that they've already seen a ton of magic. So then when I sit down in the chair and I go all Spalding Gray on them and I just start talking from the seat, they're actually able to sit back and relax and go on the journey with me, you know? And so the first half of the show is a lot more work to set up, to prepare, to rehearse, and to do. And yet, everybody was talking about the second half of the show.
Yeah.
Like, we love it when you sit down and you talk to us and you're honest and vulnerable. And that seems to be what people want these days.
Yeah.
It was a real revelation for me. The comments after the show, people really liked the first half. They were like, it was funny, it was magic. But when you sat down, and by the way, this thing happened to my dad, or I had a similar moment in my life when I wanted to do something and I was told I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
You realize that the emotional, if you can get your audience to relate emotionally in some way to what you're doing, give them some kind of context for it, the magic will hit in a far greater way.
Well, you know, all art, fine art, performing arts, whatever, they're all forms of personal expression.
Yep.
And if your magic has no personal expression in it, it's kind of like, what's the point, I think.
This is what I read in an old magic wand, and that's what affected me. This guy wrote an article about how, what is it about magicians that by the time they leave the stage, they could be on stage for 2 hours, we know nothing about them.
Yeah.
Nothing.
Yeah.
A comedian goes on stage, you know his point of view. A singer goes on stage, you know they're going to talk about their life in some way.
Yeah.
But a magician goes through, because we hide behind our tricks.
Yeah.
That's what we do.
Also in issue 50, Tyler Erickson talks about using your props to create eye contact.
Something that I will do very often if I have something happening on the surface. So if someone were standing here in front of me, looking down at the surface, they can't even see my face at all. So even if I look at them, even if I move my head, it's possible that they might not even be able to see that peripherally. So what we do is something I referred to as a connector. I take this thing that they're interested in that's on the surface, and I bring it up here. I've now dragged their eyes along with me. Now they connect to the face. At this point, so I could reach for the object, they see me reaching for it, I pick it up, and then when I look at them, I now have them to talk to. I'm connected from there. So let's suppose I was doing something like cups and balls. If I lift the cup and keep it close to the surface, they'll notice what's underneath it, they'll notice the cup. They won't see me, but if I lift the cup and then I lift the cup to show the interior empty, I've now brought them back up here with me so I can be straightened up and address them directly. This is very, very useful when working for people that have a tendency to stare at things and are burning objects and unwilling to make any sort of eye contact. Because at the very least, if I do this, you're going to be forced to see my eyes at least a little bit.
Doc Eason and Garrett Thomas discuss the difference between being a character and having character. Christian talks about his sweet tooth. and Garrett Thomas returns with Try This at Home. In this issue, Garrett discusses emphasis.
My rule is this. If it's important to the story they tell, well, the more you have to emphasize it. So we think of the word emphasize when it only comes to words. But in reality, there's ways to emphasize things without words. So whenever I'm considering where to put importance, I view it in my mind as a spotlight. If it's somewhat important, I'll put a light on it. If it's not important at all, I'll probably make sure it's black, which means to me, I eliminate it. And if it's really important, I try to create darkness around it and make the spotlight really bright. So what does that mean? Well, all the senses, not just language, not just what we say, can have this spotlight type of concept. And if you think about it that way, you can better make your own choices with the magic you're creating.
As always, we've got plenty of tricks to teach you. In this issue, there are three tricks from Jeff Price and one from Chastain Criswell.
I have a copper and a silver coin. I'm going to take one coin, the silver coin, place it over here on my elbow and rub it. Watch, it jumps out here. That means that's the copper coin. But if you would, Josh, hold your hand out for me. I'm going to place the two coins inside your hand, close your hand, turn it over like this. I'm going to reach in, I'm going to grab out one coin, I'm going to toss it to the change purse. Do you know what coin I reached in and grabbed? Yes.
Copper.
That is exactly right. Matter of fact, take your other hand, pinch the top of this. I'm going to take an, pinch the top of that. So if you would, turn this hand over, open your hand, you see that that is the silver coin. Now, I forgot to mention, I have some of the fastest hands around, because I actually took the coin out of your hand, put it inside the purse. I have the fastest hands around, so if you would, go ahead, look inside. Just look inside there and see what's in there. Copper coin, silver coin. Well, that explains why I don't have the copper coin up here in my hand. And then you can examine.
That's good.
All this and much, much more.